Hello, I'm Graham and I do hope everyone's having a great day. In this, which is part 3 of this video tutorial series covering Canon's Powershot HS series of cameras, I want today look at the aperture priority, shutter priority and manual shooting modes. Each of these modes brings its own opportunities for creative photography. If we consider aperture priority, normally we'd be using aperture priority if we want to specify a specific aperture that we want to take the picture with. Normally this will be dependent on the amount of depth of field, and by depth of field I mean just how much of the image is in focus, in front of the image and behind the image. In this shot here you can see the amount of depth of field on a close-up that I've done of this little model. You can see the background is out of focus and the foreground is out of focus and the model is quite sharp. This is due to the depth of field the lens has with a specific aperture. Normally with a wide aperture the depth of field is less. With a small aperture, say f8, the depth of field is greater. Also the depth of field is dependent on the focal length of the lens. So a short focal length gives you more depth of field than a telephoto one. So if you want to create photos with a blurry background, for example a portrait, you really need to be using the telephoto setting, be close to the subject and move the subject further away from the background. With these small sensor cameras, inherent by design, the depth of field is quite large. So even with a large aperture, say f3.1, which is the largest aperture this camera has, the depth of field is still quite considerable. And if you've noticed, when the camera shoots in auto, it normally shoots at f3.1 at wide angle, and there is tremendous depth of field in all landscape shots. So it's difficult to achieve a shallow depth of field with this particular camera. But nevertheless, if you use the telephoto setting, you can achieve some blurry background effects. If we consider the T mode, or the shutter priority mode, normally we'd use shutter priority when we want to capture either slow motion or fast motion. So for example, if you want to capture sports, you'll be using a shutter speed of about 1/1000 of a second or even 2/1000 of a second. And on the other hand, if you want to catch flowing water and make it look dreamy and silky-like, you may be looking at 1/2 a second or a 1 second exposure. Again, the choice of aperture or shutter priority will actually depend on your type of subject. The final mode is the M mode, which is the manual exposure, and it gives you full control of both the aperture and the shutter, and use the ISO to balance the exposure. This camera shoots in 1/3 of an EV increment between f-stops. Here is a scale which shows the 1/3 increment. The scale shows the full stops in green. So between f4 and f5.6, we have one full f-stop. In between that, we have the intermediate 1/3 stops. The shutter mode also gives you 1/3 increments. So for example, a 1/25th to a 1/250th is a one full stop increment. In between that, you will have the incremental 1/3 EV shutter speeds. When you look at the ISO, the ISO is in full stop increments. So the camera goes from ISO 100 to 200, which is one complete stop, then 200 to 400, which is one complete stop. So if you're working out exposure, then the relationship of exposure is ISO times manual shutter times aperture. If you change the ISO by one stop, to compensate for the exposure, you need to change either the shutter or the aperture by one stop. Equally, you could change the shutter by 1/3 and the aperture by 2/3 to achieve the same result. Let's now look at the camera in detail of how to set up the aperture priority mode, the shutter priority mode and the manual mode, and to see the effects you can achieve. So let's first of all look at the aperture priority mode, and to set aperture priority mode we need to turn the camera control dial to the AV position. And the camera will display that we're in the AV aperture priority mode. I'm first of all going to set up the tracking focus to be on this little model's face here, so that the focus point stays the same throughout these tests. To do that I need to align the target with the subject and then press the horizontal navigation button to lock the focus on that point. I can then recompose the shot and the camera will hold focus on that position. At the moment, the aperture is set to f3.5, and that's the largest aperture this lens will support at the focal length I've got set on the camera. I'm not exactly wide angle. If I go all the way out, that's the wide angle, but it shows too much of the background, so I'm cropping in slightly by using the zoom setting to achieve the crop that I want on the image. When I do that, it will change the aperture value because of the lens construction. And now I've got an aperture of f4, which is the widest aperture I can use. By turning the control dial, we can actually move up to a minimum aperture of f8. And again, that's the minimum aperture that this camera supports. So first of all, let's go down to f4 and we'll take a picture, and we can then observe the depth of field, that's the amount of focus between the first model and the one in the background. So I'll take the first image with the 2 second timer. I've got the camera on review so I can check the focus, and again this appears to be in perfect focus, so I can dismiss that. We'll now change the aperture to f8, and you can see as I'm increasing the aperture, they are going up in these 1/3 EV stops. So from f4 to f5.6 would be one complete aperture change. In between that, we've got our two intermediate 1/3 EV stops. So I'm going to go all the way to f8, and with f8 I get the maximum depth of field for this lens setting. So I'm now going to take the second picture. And again, just make sure that we have to focus on the first model, and that looks okay. So that is showing the amount of depth of field. Obviously, the depth of field will depend on the distance of the camera to the subject and the subject to the background. If I brought that second model nearer to the camera, then the depth of field will cover both models. So if we repeat that process, if I take the first shot at f4, and then change the aperture to f8 and repeat the shot, we'll see now that the second model is much more in focus. Let's now look at the shutter priority mode, and the shutter priority mode is achieved by turning the dial to the TV position. And that stands for time value. In the shutter priority mode, we now have control of the shutter speed, and the camera will control the aperture. Again, I've got a fixed ISO. So if I try to take a photograph where the camera can't achieve the exposure, then we will see this change to red. If I now take control of the shutter speed, as I decrease this, you can see that I'm going down and the equivalent of 1/3 of an EV stop. If I press the shutter button, now see that the camera is saying for this exposure it can't balance the equation, so the aperture f4 is in red. This is telling me that the f4 isn't sufficient to allow enough light into the camera to gain the correct exposure. But as we know, we can't go any less than f4. So the only way to balance this equation is either to change the ISO until the aperture is correct, or decrease the shutter speed to give me the right exposure. If I needed to take this shot handheld, I wouldn't want to go less than 1/50th of a second. So to balance the equation, I would need to change the ISO. Using the function set menu, go across to ISO, and I'm going to go down to ISO 400, which is the equivalent of two complete f-stops. And I'm going to push the shutter button, and now the camera can achieve a balance there at 1/50th at f4. So if I take this photograph, the exposure is correct. If I decrease the shutter speed from a 50th to a 25th, that's the equivalent of going down one complete f-stop. So the camera would change the aperture to f5.6 to compensate in the equation. And again, if I take this photograph now, we have the same exposure. If you've got the camera set to ISO auto, the camera first of all will try to set the camera to ISO 100 and adjust the aperture for the shutter you've got. If it can't achieve that exposure, it will then change the ISO to balance the equation. So if I half press the shutter button now, you can see the exposure is 1/80th of a second at ISO 500. So with this aperture set to f4, it can't achieve an equation balance with ISO 100, so it's driven the ISO to 500 to match. If I now decrease the shutter speed to let more light into the camera, the ISO will be driven to a less value, so we've now come down to ISO 320. And again, if I let more light into the camera by increasing the shutter speed, the ISO has come down to ISO 100. If I try to go any more, the ISO can't go below 100, so it will then start to change the aperture. And you can now see the aperture has gone to f4.5. So you're making the camera work out the equation for you by using ISO auto. There is a caveat in the menu, and it's in the setup, and it's the safety shift. If you set safety shift on, if the camera can't achieve the exposure that you want, I have dialed in an exposure now of 5 seconds. When I press the shutter button, the camera will realise that I can't achieve the exposure, and it's changed the shutter speed to give me the exposure. So beware, if you've got the safety setting set to on, whatever value you've got in the shutter speed, if the camera can't achieve exposure, it will change that shutter speed to give you an exposure. It's a safety factor, so that if you've got the camera set up in a manual mode and you want to snatch a photograph quickly, it will actually capture that exposure for you with a decent shutter speed. If you want to capture fast motion objects in shutter priority mode, then it depends on the distance of the camera to the subject and actually the speed at which the subject's moving. Here I've got a little test situation with a train running around a track, and if I try to take this picture with something like a 25th of a second, you can see the train is blurred, so the camera has not been able to stop the motion with a 25th of a second. If this is the sort of thing you want, getting creative motion, then a slow shutter speed will give you this effect. I need to be in the order of about a 500th of a second to stop this motion. So I'm going to go up to a 500th, and we'll probably need to change the ISO to about 3200 to capture it in this light. Yeah, it's capturing me with an f5. So we'll now take a picture. You can see the train is sharply in focus. So you can now see I've got ISO 100 set on the camera. The shutter speed is 1/60th and the aperture is f8. I want the shallowest depth of field, and we know that is done by going to a large aperture. The largest aperture I can set at the moment is f4, so I'm going to change the aperture to f4. And to do that, I use the up arrow key of the navigation dial to change the focus point to the aperture control. And now as I rotate the ring, you can see that I bring the aperture down. So I'm going to set this to f4. The exposure indicator is still showing that I'm underexposed, so I need to change the shutter to balance the equation. Again, using the up arrow key puts the focus back to the shutter setting, and I need to make the time longer to allow more light into the camera. So that means we need to decrease the shutter speed. And again, you have to be aware that if you push the button in, you get to focus tracking. So it's a case of just gently turning the control dial rather than actually pushing it in. As I turn the shutter speed dial, you notice the shutter speed reduces and the exposure indicator is now showing the change in exposure. And as I approach the center point, that is the correct exposure. If I go beyond that, you'll see that we go overexposed. And this is a way of putting exposure compensation into a picture. There's no exposure compensation in manual control. You do that by balancing the equation to either give you an overexposed or underexposed picture. So here I want a normally exposed picture, so the indicator is aligned with the center point. And again, if I take this picture now, the camera will take that exposure for me. If I wanted f8, of course, then I changed the aperture by using the up navigation key across to f8. And then again, I've got to balance the equation by going over to the shutter speed and reduce that until we get the correct exposure. And here we have now a quarter of a second at f8. So if you wanted to set the camera up for a specific exposure and say a half a second for capturing water, then you would use the manual exposure, set the camera to give you a half a second, set your aperture to give you the maximum depth of field, and then balance the equation by changing the ISO. Well, that's it for this video. Thanks very much for watching. In the next video, we'll cover shooting video with this camera and some of the creative effects you can apply in the video mode. If you don't already subscribe to this channel, please consider doing so, as then you'll be automatically notified when I do upload the next in this series. So once again, thanks for your attention, thanks so much for watching, and I hope to see you in the next video. Bye for now.